हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वार्म वेलकम बैक टू आवर लेक्चर्स फॉर बिजनेस रेगुलेटरी फ्रेमवर्क विच वी ऑल्सो कॉल एज मर्केंटाइल लॉ फॉर थर्ड ईयर बीकॉम। वी विल कंटिन्यू स्टूडेंट्स फ्रॉम वेयर वी लेफ्ट इन द लास्ट क्लास। वी विल कंटिन्यू द डिस्कशन एंड आई होप यू लाइक द फर्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ द लेक्चर। वी आर नाउ गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द सेकेंड लेक्चर फॉर दिस सब्जेक्ट। So, just a quick run through of what we learned in the previous class. We went through the definition of contract. We learned about what is contract according to the Indian Contract Act 1872. Okay, we also saw what is the meaning of an agreement. What is a contract? Is agreement plus enforceability by law. Then we learned what is an agreement. Agreement is nothing but agreement proposal plus acceptance of proposal. Okay, it's actually a promise. Then we learned essential elements of a valid contract. So I'll give you a quick run through, a quick revision of what we have done so far. So I'll just take up an example and I'll frame a contract for you. So what do we mean by contract? I'll just give you an example. Suppose I own a mobile phone. I currently own an Apple iPhone 11, and when I purchased it, it costed a quite high amount. But now I am ready to sell it. So I am giving an offer to you. I'm just placing an offer in front of you. I want to sell my iPhone 11 to you for rupees 40,000. So this is a offer given by me to you. I'll share the pictures of the phone. I'll share the capacity, the version. I'll also share the bill details, the box details, everything. I'll share it with you, right? And this is my blunt, plain offer to you. Now, when I'm giving this offer to you, there is a product involved here. And there is a price involved here, and I'm giving you an offer. So this is my offer. Now, if you liked the product and everything, and you want to go ahead with it, okay? So then you will say, I accept the offer. So what did we do now? I proposed something to you, okay? You liked the idea. You thought it is a fair deal. I'm getting an iPhone 11 which was worth more than a lakh rupee, and now I'm getting it for 40,000, which is used for just a period of 3 to 4 months, and it is as good as brand new. It has not got damaged from anywhere, and I've seen everything, and now you think it is a fair deal. So you accept my offer. You say that I accept it. Now, when I give you an offer and when you accept that offer, okay, when these two things happen, it is called as an agreement. You need to understand that. So what is an agreement? There is a proposal. So there is an agreement proposal, and there is acceptance of this proposal. When agreement proposal is accepted by the person in front, it is called as an agreement. It's like a promise. Agreement is nothing but a promise. So agreement. Now, if the agreement is enforceable by law. Enforceable by law means what? That in case the money that you gave me turned out that it was not fair money, it was I cannot use it because it is some duplicate money that you have given me. The cash, the amount that you have given me is duplicate, so it is very difficult for me to use that money. So can I now file a case against you? And if the answer is yes, that means this agreement is enforceable by law. And just because this agreement is enforceable by law, it turns out that it is a contract. So simple. So if either of the parties, either you or me, one of us should be in a position to file a case on each other. If we are able to do that, that means that agreement is enforceable by law. So suppose the phone which I gave you, it is actually a damaged phone. Internally, it has got a lot of damage. You are not able to use the screen properly. okay, you didn't check the screen. I somehow cheated you into showing you the screen which was just temporarily working. As soon as you bought the phone, you paid the money to me. When you went and started using the phone, you saw that the screen is not working. Now, can you file a case against me? The answer is yes. Why? Because when we entered into a contract, when I gave you a proposal, I was willing to, get money from you for that. And even you were willing to pay the money. I was willing to give you a product which is in good condition. So both of us, we wanted to get into a deal, okay? And both of us didn't want to get cheated. Neither did I want that you cheat me, nor did you want that I should cheat you. So the situation here, it became as such that we both wanted to do a lawful agreement. We both wanted to get into a legal way of dealing into things. Why? Because tomorrow, if anything wrong happens, either with you or me, one of us, whoever is bearing this problem, should be in a position to file a case against the other. So this is the whole concept of enforceability by law. Okay. So now, what is a contract? If I ask, if I say, what is a contract? So you should be able to tell an equation. You should be able to say, contract is equal to an agreement plus enforceability by law. Simple. So if I say, what is an agreement then? So you should say, agreement is nothing but proposal plus acceptance. Proposal plus acceptance, or offer plus acceptance. So I gave you an offer, you like my offer, you accept. That is an agreement. Now if I ask you a question just on the basis of agreement, can you file a case against me? The answer is no. However, if you form a contract with me, can you file a case on me? Yes. So if there is just an agreement, no, you cannot file a case against me. But if it is a contract, then you can file a case against me because it became legal, right? So enforceability by law means your right to file a case against me and my right to file a case against you. If we fall into an agreement, and if it is legal, only then it will be turned as a contract. Okay. Now, the other day when I was taking the first lecture, I shared something about two types of agreements. I'll just quickly revise that. So there's a concept called as social agreement. Now, what do you mean by that? What do you mean by the word social agreement? So let us say I said that, if you secure above 75% marks, I'll call a party. So I'll invite all your friends, and the party is on me. I will do the investment and the party is on me. So this is what I said. So now what happened is that you secured 77% in your boards. Okay, so now you're waiting for me to honor that proposal which I gave. I gave you a proposal that I'll throw a party if you get more than 75%. So now you're waiting for me to throw a party. Now what do? I don't throw that party. Okay, can you file a case against me? The big answer is no. Why? Because we entered into a social agreement, and it has nothing related, nothing legal related to that agreement. There was nothing which which binds me to follow that what I said. Neither can you do anything, nor can I. So it is like I called for a party and you didn't turn up, and then I file a case against you. That can also not be done, right? So social agreement has no standing here. It has to be enforceable by law. So a quick discussion which I had to have regarding the definitions that we learned. We learned about contract, we learned about agreement. Okay, then we also discussed in detail about essential elements of a valid contract. Now this is a very important portion that you have to understand. Essential elements of a valid contract, it comes under, remember students, it comes under section 10. So you need to remember section 10, and these are those 10 points. It is related to enforceability by law. So when you make an agreement and you follow all the 10 essentials of a valid contract, that means you have followed enforceability by law. That's straight explanation of essentials of a valid contract. So we went through all of this, which means what are the 10 essential points to form a contract. So we learned, okay, there should be two parties, minimum two parties. So two parties should be there. So there has to be one person and another person. Now basically, who are these two parties? The one who gives the offer, it's called as an offerer, and the other to whom the offer is being given is called as offeree. So two parties have to be there. There has to be an offer and acceptance. There has to be an offer. Offer is also called as proposal. So without an offer and acceptance, contract cannot come into picture. So it is not that, you will directly come to me, take my phone, give me the money and go away. And you say that, see, we had a deal. I gave you 40,000, I took away your phone and that's it. It cannot happen. It has to be an offer. Either you give an offer, you come and tell that I want to pay 40,000 to you for your phone. Then I'll think about it. Okay, should we pay this? Should we sell this phone and take that 40,000 rupees? If I like your offer, I'll accept it. So it can be offer given by me, the one who is selling the phone, or it can be the otherwise also. The offer can be given by you as well, right? So there has to be an offer and there has to be an acceptance. Third and the most important point, intention to create a legal relationship, which means, like I said about social agreement. So suppose if I say that you are waiting on a road and you waved your hand, you were looking for some lift, you had to reach somewhere. So I was driving smoothly and I saw a couple of you guys waiting, waving hands, looking for some kind of a transport, and I made you sit in there, right? Now I dropped you at your place, which was say 10 kilometers away, and as I dropped you just before the destination, I told you, okay, come on now, each one of you give me 100 rupees. Okay, so is it necessary for you to pay me those 100 rupees? The answer is no, because I just did a social friendly favor to you. I didn't give you a proposal. I didn't, call you out and told that, I'll drop you to your place, but each one of you will have to give me 100 rupees. I didn't give any kind of an offer, or my intention was not there to create any legal relationship. I'm not into the service of picking and dropping people. I'm not a rickshaw man or a cab man. I just thought I'll help you. So with that intention of helping you, I cannot charge you money. And if I tell that, okay, if you don't pay me money, I'll file a case against you, it is not possible, because my intention was not to create a legal relationship. It was just a social agreement that we had that I'll drop you, right? So that's why whatever kind of a contract you frame, it has to have a legal relationship. Next is free consent. It's a very comprehensive and interesting point, that I cannot frame a contract if I do not get free consent from you. Free consent is your agreement. So all these things we'll discuss. We'll discuss what is coercion. We'll discuss what is undue influence, fraud, misrepresentation, mistake. Each of them is a topic. I'll just tell you in simple that nobody should be able to force you to get into a contract. So suppose if there's a person who comes at my home, and at gunpoint, he says that, okay, you leave this place, you leave your flat, okay, which is worth, let's say, 1 crore rupees. And he tells, I'll give you 20 lakh rupees and you leave. Okay, now he's keeping gun on my head and telling that. And I'm not able to do that because, for me, my life is very important. So I somehow leave the house, he transfers some money, say 10 lakh rupees in my account, and now he's living in my flat. Okay, so this whole activity that has happened of, him paying me money and buying my flat for a, dirt cheap rate, 1/5 is what the person is willing to pay. So I am not giving any free consent. I'm not happily entering into a contract with him like that. So there is no free consent. So if my permission is there, my admission is there, my acceptance is there, only then we can say that there is a free consent. But here it didn't happen like that. Next is competent party. So what is the meaning of competent party? A contract must have three kinds of people. So you need to remember this. Who are these three people? We'll discuss it in much, much detail. But as of now, remember three people. One is whoever is doing the contract should be above 18 years of age. Okay. Now you all have completed your class 12th. You are in your third year BCom. You all are legal people who can enter into a contract. Okay. So if you are above 18 years of age, you can enter into a contract. That is the first point. Second is what? You need to be of a sound mind. Sound mind means you should not be a mad person. You should not be a lunatic. Okay? Should be in normal senses, normal human being. Third point is that you should not be, there should not be any case going on against you. You should not be facing any kind of legal problems, legal disqualification. और यू शुड नॉट बी एन इंसॉल्वेंट. आई मीन आप कंगाल नहीं होने चाहिए. अगर आपके पास पैसा नहीं है और आपको गवर्नमेंट ने कोर्ट ने डिक्लेयर किया है दैट यू आर इंसॉल्वेंट, सो यू कैन नॉट एंटर इनटू अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. सो थ्री थिंग्स आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट इफ यू वांट टू एंटर इनटू अ कॉन्ट्रैक्ट. यू हैव टू बी अबव द एज ऑफ 18, यू हैव टू बी अ पर्सन विद साउंड माइंड, एंड यू हैव टू बी अ पर्सन हु इज नॉट डिसक्वालिफाइड. सो वी विल डिस्कस दिस इन डिटेल. If you are all these things, that means you are competent party. Next is lawful object. Whatever is the contract that you are entering into, it should be legal. So if you decided that, okay, we will smuggle gold, or we'll do drugs peddling, we'll collect drugs and everything. So if you get into anything which has an illegal object, the aim is illegal, that means it is not a valid contract. Lawful consideration, the kind of money that you're going to give me. If you tell me that, okay, I'll give you, illegal money, some black money I'll give you, okay? Or you're going to give me some amount which you have robbed from somewhere, okay? So the consideration which you're going to give me, it has to be legal. Consideration, as of now you understand, consideration means something in return, which means as of now, you understand that it is money. So if you pay me money by robbing, if you, instead of money, you are just giving me some gold, some illegal object you are giving me. Okay, so that is not allowed. Then it is not a valid contract. Certainty and possibility of performance. This means what? That whatever act we are getting into, it has to be possible to be done. So you cannot sit and predict that, okay, let's say we'll enter into a situation where I'll pay you 1 lakh rupees if corona vaccine comes out on the 1st of November. Okay, so if on 1st of November, Indian government starts giving out corona vaccine produced in India, okay, if they do that, I pay you 1 lakh rupees. Now, there is no possibility here, there is no certainty here. Even the people from the government are not able to say that. So can we get into such kind of contracts? The answer is a big no, because it doesn't make our contract valid. Okay. So whatever you are getting into, it has to be certain and the performance should be possible. Next is agreements not declared void. Okay. Now there are certain agreements which are legally already declared void by the government. So they have expressly declared, they have told that, see, this is what which is prohibited. So when you go to a place like Gujarat where liquor is prohibited, so it is expressly informed that you cannot have liquor here. It is expressly told that you cannot have cricket match fixing here in India. You cannot get into any kind of betting here. Okay. So it is expressly told. And if you get into such contracts, that means that contract is not valid. And the last point is legal formalities, which means what? If there is any form to be filled, okay? All the forms that are required to be filled must be filled. If they are filled, only then it is a legal and a valid contract. So, which is simple, that if you are buying an immovable property, if you are buying flat, if you are buying a commercial property, so there is a requirement of a document. You have to pay some stamp duty. You have to give the name of the owner of the contract, whoever is going to buy the property. So if they say that if in order to enter into a contract, you know, you have to follow these legal formalities, and if it is required, you'll have to do it. Okay. So these are the most important 10 essential elements of a valid contract. Students, if you face any more problems in understanding any of the concepts, you can definitely raise your doubts. There is a channel through which we can enter into doubt solving. You have your books, you all can read through it. It's a very interesting concept that we are going through. If any of the points you feel you need a better explanation or a repeat explanation, I'll see to it in my upcoming lectures. That part is included into your session. Okay. So we are now moving to the next part, that is kinds of contracts. It's a very interesting part again. We are trying to learn what kinds of contracts do we have. Now there are four bases of a contract. There is a basis of mode of formation. Okay. Then we have extent of execution or performance. Then we have what kind of form of contracts we have. Then we have enforceability or validity. So we'll take each of it in a very small explanation for each of it. Some are very plain and easy to understand. Some require more understanding, so I'll cover up according to the requirement. On the basis of mode of formation, very simple. We have express, implied and quasi. I'll explain all three to you. What is an express contract? Express is either oral or written contract. So it is very much possible that you can have oral contracts, which means orally you called up a friend and orally you told, I want to sell my mobile phone to you for ₹40,000. Do you accept the offer? The person in the front says, yes, I accept the offer. Done. That is a oral contract. When you orally doing it, that comes under express contracts. So a contract can be oral or written. So if you have a written offer, so suppose you write a text message or you write a WhatsApp message, I want to sell my phone iPhone 11 for ₹40,000, and you send that text message along with the pictures to your friend, and he accepts that offer, that is also valid, no problem. So express contracts means either oral or written. Then we have implied contracts. Implied contracts means the contracts which are considered to be contracts. Okay, I'll tell you an example here. Suppose you are waiting at a bus stop. Okay, so when you're waiting at a bus stop, a bus arrives. When the bus arrives, bus is giving out an implied offer to you. The bus is telling that if you board the bus, okay, we will drop you from this place to that place and we'll charge you money. They are not going to announce it. There's not going to be a conductor taking a mic in his hand and telling, okay, from this place to that place, okay, this, that. No, they don't have time. They'll not get into doing that. So bus comes, you're standing at the bus stop. When the bus arrives, that is called as an implied offer. The moment you put your feet on the bus, that is called as implied acceptance. You accepted it. Now you're sitting in the bus. The conductor will come and he'll ask you money. Okay, he'll ask you destination. You'll tell, okay, suppose you're from Pune, you'll say, okay, I want to reach till Pune railway station. The conductor would tell the place where you have boarded the bus from, it costs you 20 rupees. Okay, and this is your ticket. The conductor will give you the ticket and he'll take the money. And they'll, you know, as the rule goes by, they'll drop you at the Pune railway station. Simple transaction. So what do you mean by implied contract? Implied is that there's no need to express. There's no need to tell anybody. It is understood. Okay. It is very well understood. So when you say implied contract, then let us say you are standing outside an automated teller machine, that is an ATM. When you're going to the ATM and you're pressing the buttons, inserting the card, you're talking to the ATM. It is very well implied. ATM is telling you that, you know, if you insert your card, I am giving you an offer that if you insert your card, I'll be able to dispense some money for you. Well, that is an implied offer. If you insert the card, you insert the details of your card and you then accept the offer telling that I want to withdraw 2000 rupees. okay, and then the money comes out. So that's an implied contract. So implied offer, implied acceptance, implied contract, money came out, that's it, implied contract. Third is a Kasi contract. Now Kasi contract is actually not a type of a contract, but we face a situation where we have to follow it. So I'll give you an example. What do you mean by Kasi contract? So suppose you you were walking by and you saw you saw a wallet there on the ground. You picked up the wallet, you checked, okay, there's a check there with a person's name written. You saw the identity cards also of that person, so you saw a wallet, okay, and there's some check also along with that. Now the moment you pick that up, okay, you are bounded by a contract. Now, what is the contract? It's very simple. You will have to take that wallet and give it to the person whose it is. So it's your duty and responsibility according to the Indian Contract Act 1872. Okay, you will be held responsible to drop that wallet to that person. If you don't do that, and if by some means it is identified that you had picked it up, you will be considered as the thief of the wallet. Okay, so you have to be careful. So nowadays everywhere we have web cameras, so you know, there are a lot of cameras, CCTV cameras, closed circuit cameras installed everywhere. So it's very easy nowadays. So if you go and pick it up and you don't deliver, so again you are gone, you will be considered as a robber. Here what I'm trying to say is that the moment you take the purse, you accepted an offer lying on the road. So there was a offer given that, okay, this is a wallet. You need to give this wallet back to the person whose it is. And you picked up the wallet. Now you have accepted that offer. So Kasi contract is what? It's not a contract actually, because for a contract, if you all remember, there has to be two or more parties. There has to be an offer and an acceptance. There has to be an intention to create a legal relationship. There has to be a free consent. How can, you know, nobody has asked you that, okay, do you really want to drop this wallet? You might as well have left that wallet on the road. So again, free consent has not been taken. You know, we don't know about other points, but at least these top 3 points or two or more parties are not applicable on this. So basically it is not a contract. It is just an example which I've given you. You end up getting someone's ring and it is your moral duty to keep trying to find out whose ring that it is. So you are tied up into a contract morally. Okay, so this is on the basis of mode of formation. Then we have on the basis of extent of execution or performance of contract. Okay, now what happens is we enter into a contract. I'll give you an example again. I decided to propose or give you an offer that I want to sell my Hyundai Grand i10 to you for 2 lakh rupees. It's a 5 year old car and I'm wanting to sell it to you for rupees 2 lakhs. It is undamaged, never an accident, in a mint quality. You can check yourself. Now I gave you an offer. Okay. You accepted the offer. You said that, okay, I'm ready to do it, but I want some installments. I want to pay it into 4 installments of 50,000 each. Once I complete the installments, I'll take the car away and go. Straight deal. So, okay, I gave you an offer. You accepted the offer. Done. Now, we both are yet to do our performance. What is the meaning of performance? My performance will be to give you the keys of the car, to give you the insurance papers, to give you the car, finally. That is my performance. What is your performance? To give me the whole money, that is 2 lakh rupees, right? Now, when I give you the car and you give me the money, that is called as executed contract. So we had a contract, we did our performance and the contract got executed. The other part is executory contract, which means you paid 2 lakh rupees to me from your end, okay, and I am yet to make a payment. So it is executory contract from my end. It is also possible that both of us are doing an executory contract, which means you paid 1 lakh rupees, I gave you the keys. So from my end also, it is not executed, it is executory. And from your end also, it is not executed, it is executory. Executory means yet to be performed. So neither have I performed it nor have you. So executory contract. Then there's a concept called as unilateral contract. Now unilateral contract is one of us has to perform that contract. Okay, so suppose it doesn't happen though, but I'm just giving you a random example, is that when I gift you something from one end, that let's say I give you tickets to watch a movie, you go and perform, or you go and watch the movie. That's it. It's a unilateral. One person has to perform. Okay. Bilateral, all the contracts are bilaterals. Both the people have to perform. Okay. Unilateral, one person has to perform. Bilateral, both the parties have to perform. Executed, both of us have finished performing. Executory, either both of us are yet to perform, or one of us is yet to perform. Okay, or even both of us have performed half of it, and we are yet to perform the remaining half of the contract. So this is on the basis of execution or performance of a contract. Okay, so students, with this I will end today's lecture number 2. We'll continue from the remaining kinds of contract in our next session. And so you have your textbooks, you all can start reading through it, and if you have any problems, you can get in touch with me. We'll tell you how to get access. Thank you so much for listening to me. I'll catch you soon for the third lecture. Okay, bye bye.